Hey, it's John from Enduring Charm. You know, I'm supposed to be cleaning the shop right now. I just have zero motivation to do it. So I was thinking about some of the animals that I've come across over the years in various projects that I've done. Some are wild animals, some are pets. And I was just getting a chuckle to myself, and I thought I'd share some of these stories with you. And maybe if you have some stories of your own, you could leave them in the comments. And we'll start off the year with something fun instead of so serious. The wild animals that I've come across over the years, you know, I have the usual, you see mice in the walls, for example, you know, everybody has that. Actually, one time the worst I've ever seen, I had a kitchen job that I was doing. I opened up, you know, took off some drywall and opened up a wall. And there was one stud cavity that was just, it was the grossest thing I've seen, well, almost the grossest thing I've ever seen. The previous owner had used poison over the years, which is not a good idea, by the way, because it's just a terrible way to die. But they had used poison over the years, and there was just layers of mice. And I mean, it was probably almost 2 feet tall in a stud bay. And the bottom layers were basically dirt. And as you got your way higher, you know, you'd see some bones, and then you got a little higher, and then you'd see mice with skin, and a little higher, and they started to be fresh. It was really nasty. And I was just remembering another gross time. This is real early on in my career, where I had to get into a crawl space. And when I say crawl space, I mean it was like, you know, 6 or 8 inches. You really were down in the dirt, and there's really nowhere to go. I forget even why I had to go through this, but there was a corner I had to get to. I remember that. It was dark, and it was just, you know, just dirt floor, just nasty to begin with. And I started to crawl in there, and you're just, you know, scooching along there with a flashlight. And I just remember coming face to face with this dead possum. I think it was also poison. And not that dead. I mean, it's probably been a day or two that it died. And it had thrown up, and the vomit was just coming out of its mouth, and it was dried up. And I just came face to face with this thing, and I'm like, oh. I ended up, I think I put a shovel, I came back out, I put a shovel in front of me, and I kind of scooped it under this thing and dragged it out that way to get it out. But enough of dead animals. But I've had a bunch of, you know, encounters with live animals, wild animals, that have been kind of amusing. I remember one time in particular, I was working on a garage, and there was really wide overhang on these soffits. And the soffits were all rotted, and the trim was all rotted. I was taking everything down. So I was up on a ladder. I think it might have been an 8-foot ladder. And I was working on these soffits, just really yanking on them to get them all down. I got most of them down. I was on the last one, so they were like 8-foot sections. And I was, man, just rusty nails, and I couldn't get this thing out. And I finally put all my weight onto it and yanked it off. And as I did, 3 fur balls, boom, 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 dropped down into the ground. And I was shocked as they were, and I looked down, it was raccoons, like baby raccoons, and they were all disoriented and running about there. They went around in circles for about a minute and then scattered in different directions, but I was laughing so hard on that ladder, I just about fell off. Of course, another animal like that, or I guess, I don't know what that, I guess it is an animal, are bats. You see bats all the time. And one house I worked on in particular, we had, it was a really old house, like 1700s, and the shutters, the wood shutters, had to come off. We were doing siding or trim or something, and every shutter you'd pull, you know, to, you know, the shutter dogs, you'd open them up and turn the shutter, and there'd be bats under there, sometimes 2 or 3 behind each shutter. And of course, it was the middle of day for us, but to them it's the middle of the night, so you could pick them right up, and they'd be kind of irritated, like, you know, what am I doing here? You pick them up, and we used to put them up on the tree. And they'd sit there for a few minutes and kind of dazed, and eventually they'd fly off irritated. But with that same house, I remember there was one section of this house where, you know, a roof came, like a shed roof came down, and it was completely enclosed. There was no access from the inside. But there was a couple areas where obviously animals, and it looked like squirrels, had gotten in. So we were trying to patch everything up, and we got up on a ladder and looked into this section so you could see, you know, the ceiling was here and the shed roof was coming down here, and we could just see in there. There was, I mean, just layer upon layer upon layer of walnut shells. I mean, it was 6 to 8 inches, maybe a foot deep in areas. And there was an old walnut tree that had been there for, you know, ever. And I think for decades and decades, squirrels have been getting these walnuts and, you know, bring them into this attic area to eat, and they would just leave them there. So there was this huge layer of walnuts, And there was nothing we could do about it. I mean, it must have weighed a ton, but there was no access to get in there. So all we did was close it up and left it there. But someday somebody's going to do a remodel and get a surprise when they open up that ceiling. Insects are constantly around. A lot of times, you know, you get up on a ladder, and if you're replacing wood siding or wood trim or something like that, and you can see carpenter bee holes or, you know, bee nests, you know, sometimes you just knock on the siding and you hear that angry buzzing start, and you know it's time to get down off that ladder. Around where I am here in the Northeast, we also have stink bugs, which I think are from Asia, but they're just really nasty. And in the when the weather turns cold, they'll get up underneath the siding, the trim, and everything. And a lot of times, you'll just pull off a piece of siding or trim, and there's just billions of these things. They're really gross. And sometimes they'll swarm around you. They don't really bite or anything, but they're just really nasty and they smell like hell. So you have that to deal with. But one of my favorite wild animal stories, there's a woman I did a whole bunch of work for, and it was in a summertime period, and I finished up the work and got everything completed, and I left, and everything was good. And then I got a call from her maybe, I don't know, a month or two later. And she thinks that a bird had made a nest in a column in her front porch. Now, these front porch columns went two stories high. They were made of aluminum, and they had, you know, at the base, they had like an aluminum base, and at the top, same thing. And they were just kind of, you would slide down there, and you would caulk around it. And, you know, these were popular in the 70s. So that's what this thing was made of. So these aluminum columns are hollow in the middle, and they go this full two stories. Well, she could hear something, you know, bumping around inside one of the columns. And I'm like, you know, it's hard for me to imagine a mouse or anything getting through this aluminum. And I knew it was caulked down, so I couldn't imagine what could have happened. But I said I'd come over and see if I could help. At first, I didn't hear anything. And I'm like, I started to think she was crazy. And, you know, we were making small talk. And finally, I'm like, you know, I don't think there's anything here, but, you know, best of luck to you kind of thing. But as I was leaving, I heard something inside one of the columns. And I'm like, oh. Then I started poking around some more, and if we, you know, knocked in certain areas of this column, which had a hollow ringing sound to it, you know, we could hear something bumping back. So I'm like, oh shit, something's actually in there. A bird had made or tried to make a nest at the very top of this column, and it was just, you know, teetering on there, not the smartest bird in the world. And the nest, I guess, had fallen with the bird in it inside this column. So it had come down two stories inside this column down to the bottom. I don't know what I'm going to do about this. I mean, it's a terrible way to die, and I felt bad, but, you know, it's a two-story column, and, you know, she didn't really want to get into removing this thing if she could help it. But so I'm like, let me get some tools. Let me see what I can do. So I ended up, I took the caulk off around the base of this thing, and I was able to lift up that aluminum base. I could kick the bottom of this column and kind of kick it out. And my goal was to try to kick out the column towards the edge of this porch. It had, you know, bricks around the edge. And if I could get enough, you know, of it to come out, maybe the bird could come out too. So I ended up doing that. It took me about 10 or 15 minutes, and I was just kicking it. And I realized it wasn't weight bearing, so it really didn't matter. But I didn't want the two story column to drop on me either. So I got this thing towards the edge. And as I did, I could see two little feet sticking out. And so I knew the bird was alive. And then I got a little more, and I could see the beak coming out, and he was, you know, looking for air, and just a little bit more, and we just kind of moved away to give it some space, and suddenly this little bird came out. In fact, I got a little, the client sent me a little picture, a little GIF of this. I'll try to post it if I can. So the bird came out, and, you know, was a little disoriented at first, and then it flew off to a bushes, and we knew it was going to be okay. Now, aside from wild animals, I get pets all the time, you know, dogs and cats and rabbits and birds and all sorts of stuff. So some of those can be, some of them are annoying, to be honest with you. I mean, some of the dogs, you know, they never let up. I've noticed something about large dogs, though, is that a lot of times when the homeowner is home, these dogs will be, you know, barking nonstop and very protective. And every time I move, you know, it's a big commotion. But as soon as the homeowner leaves for work or whatever, these dogs will lay right down and go to sleep. They could care less about me. The small dogs, though, are the ones that often give me problems. So I can remember one time we were tiling this large bathroom, and this little small dog was running around, and the homeowner, was like, oh, he's well behaved, don't worry, it won't be a problem. And he wasn't while we were doing the work and the homeowner was there. We finished up for the day. We finished grouting this whole bathroom, and it was walls and floor and everything. And it was quite a while to do. So everything was perfect, and we were just exiting the bathroom. And I said to the homeowner, you know, I'll put up some kind of barrier here so the dog doesn't get in. Oh, no, 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 don't worry about it. The dog won't be a bother. I'll take care. Okay, so, you know, I'm still cleaning up, thinking to myself, maybe I should put something down. And as we're cleaning up the tools, I just about finished everything. I came back in, and that dog had gotten into the bathroom and with a little tiny paws had walked all around the tile, and there were paw marks in all the grout. I mean, I was just really, we were able to save it. I mean, the grout wasn't that dry yet, so I quick pulled out a sponge and, you know, redid most of it. But after that, I put up a little barrier so the dog couldn't get in. But another little dog one time gave me the scare of my life. I was working on this house. It was a whole bunch of just a little odds and ends on this really old house. And the homeowner had left, and he had a job like an hour and a half away. So this little dog was home, and he asked if I wouldn't mind letting the dog out during the middle of the day, just, you know, so he could go to the bathroom and he didn't have to worry about getting a dog sitter or something like that. I said, sure, no problem. But, you know, I asked, you know, is the dog gonna run on me? And because this wasn't an enclosed area at all. Is it gonna be a problem? No, 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 the dog's fine. He's just a little thing, he's about this big. You know, it's cold out, it was the middle of winter, it was like 20 degrees out. And he said the dog would be fine. He'd go out and do his thing and he'd come right back in. Around midday, you know, the dog obviously needed to go out. So I let the dog out and I walked down with him, and you know, he seemed to be okay. I was waiting for him to do his thing, and he walked about 10 feet away, turned around and looked up at me straight in the eye, and then turned around and took off like a shot. I'm like, oh, you've got to be kidding me. So I'm running after this dog, but I went around the side of the house where the dog went and he was gone. I'm panicked now. So I'm like, I'm looking all around the house, trying to stay calm. About a half hour goes by, I'm not finding this dog. The dog's not coming back. And like I said, it's 20 degrees out and this little thing, you know, should not be outside. So a neighbor was nearby. I saw him and I told the neighbor. So he was helping me look, and we're looking for like an hour and nothing's happening. So now I'm like, oh, Jesus. I mean, I killed this guy's dog. He's never going to forgive me. I mean, this thing's going to freeze to death out here in about 10 minutes, right? Called the owner, you know, explained the situation. He was very patient and he said, you know, the dog will come back. Don't worry about it. So I go about my work. Another hour or two goes by and nothing. The dog's not coming back. So now I'm, you know, I'm shitting Twinkies, right? I figure this is the end of it. So I called the homeowner, explained the situation. He was very understanding about it, but obviously, you know, concerned. The night goes by. In the morning, I finally get word that this dog had gotten a mile and a half away, and some neighbor a mile and a half away had found the dog, picked him up, brought him inside so he was warm. And so he's probably only out like an hour maybe. But, you know, we were dying that whole time, or I was. And then he dropped him off at a vet or something. So they were reunited. Everything was fine. There was no problem. But after that, I was always a lot more cautious about dogs. And I'll still, you know, bring a dog out for a homeowner if they ask me to. But I make sure there's a leash and, you know, there's no issues as far as that. Now, cats, you would think, would be another story, right? Cats generally do leave me alone. They go in a corner and they sleep. Maybe they're irritated that, you know, I'm making noise or whatever. But it was one time I was doing some bath remodels for a woman, and they had these two cats. I think they were brothers. I think they're called Savannah cats. They're enormous, absolutely huge. So when I first walked into this house, they were like laying across the steps in the entryway. And I mean, they're like dog size. They're unbelievable. So, and really interesting looking animals too, but a little creepy. So I went about my work, and at first, you know, I didn't really notice anything, but every once in a while I would hear like a boom, boom. And it was these two cats jumping off furniture or jumping off the stairs or whatever. And they weighed so much, they would actually make a, you know, a thump when they hit the ground. So I'm kind of paying attention. And at some point the homeowner left, and then these cats started getting real curious about me, right? With the homeowner gone. So, you know, I turn around and I'd see like a shadow and something sneaking over here. And, you know, as I got involved in my work and I'm really not paying too much attention to the cats, at some point they got real close and I turn around and, oh crap, what the, and these things would be like right there, and then they'd skitter off somewhere. A little more time went by and I got really involved in what I was doing. And I turned around at one point and I was like, hey, Mr. Contractor Man, We're gonna eat you. Yeah, Mr. Contractor Man, we're not gonna leave any evidence either. These two cats were just right in my face. And I, you know, they weren't a bother. They didn't really, they're just creepy, you know, because they were just so big and would sneak around and all of a sudden they'd be in your face. But had a good time with them after a few days. So anyway, that's my animal stories. If you have some of your own, I'd really like to read them. Put your story in the comment. I don't care if you're a contractor or a homeowner or whatever. I'd love to read about your animal stories. Just something fun to start the new year with. Looks like I do need to start cleaning up my shop, so I'm going to get to that. And we'll start this new year with some new videos.